Very good afternoon to everybody. My name is Shashank Sharma, and on behalf of Scorny Solutions Private Limited, I would like to welcome you all to this webinar on digital payments and use of technology in the lending. We say that these are, the two topics are the next harbingers of the growth for the new normal. To address this topic, we have, two industry veterans with us, both coming from backgrounds, which speak for themselves in itself. So we have Mr. A.P. Hota with us, who was, former CGM of Reserve Bank of India, and who has headed the first payment system departments there. And post that, the Payment System Act was legislated, where NEFT was launched, check system was introduced in the idea of the creation of NPCI. From there, he was deputed to NPCI, where he became the first MD and CEO. And he had spent 7 years with the organization from that note. During his tenure at NPCI, he introduced several payment systems like IMPS, UPI, EPS, and DTPS, RuPay, which has now become one of the most successful domestic cards payment system, was also launched under his guidance. And he has laid a solid foundation stone of NPCI, which has now become a critical institution for the country, and UPI has become a model for many countries going for real-time transactions. Now, post his retirement from NPCI, he is an independent director of a few companies, including Federal Bank, and a consultant for Swift India Domestic Services Private Limited. We also have with us Mr. Animesh Chauhan, who is a seasoned banker. And post starting as a credit officer in 1979, he has spent his entire career in the banking domain, ranging with four different banks, including Bank of Baroda, Central Bank of India, Nainital Bank, and Oriental Bank of Commerce. He had taken over the charge of MD and CEO for Oriental Bank of Commerce. During his tenure at Bank of Baroda, he was also a part of team which represents the bank in the United Kingdom. Post his retirement, he is now an advisor to PNB on the merger amalgamation, and also we are blessed that he's on the board of Scorny Solutions also. During his tenure, he has been fundamental in the processes of business process re-engineering and reorganization of the banks. So, on behalf of Scorny Solutions, we'd like to welcome you here, sir.
Thank you and good afternoon.
Sir, before we start, I think we have just lost track of Hota, sir. I'll just try to get him back online. So, sir, meanwhile, Hota sir joins in. So, probably what we can do is we can start off with the lending part of this session. So, just to be clear with everybody who is in that in this part, so any questions that you have, you can then post in the Q&A section in the webinar, and then we can address these questions one by one once we end the panel discussion. So, Animesh sir, as we are already looking at that there is a multifold, what I would say, change in the lending system which has happened in the Indian industry. Although we have seen there's a lot of digitization which is happening over around there. So, I would request if you can just give us a slight overview where as to where are we standing with respect to use of technology in the lending domain today. And also, how has this transformed in the previous years from that side?
See, if you go 10 years back into Indian lending space, the financial services space, there was hardly any use of technology in the lending platforms. Though we had core banking system in place and a lot of technology in transactions in the bank, but lending space, there was very little use of technology. But of late, if you see the present situation, the fintechs which are lending on their platforms, it is end-to-end technology driven, but that is a very small segment of the overall lending ecosystem in the country. then NBFCs, private banks, and public sector banks as well have tried to develop loan operating systems where they take a few inputs and use that in a big way to decide on a loan, on a lending decision. And at the lower end of the lending, that means when you take personal loans or the smaller business loans, the things that are to be analyzed, the systems that need to be analyzed are less. So say, for example, a salaried class person requiring a personal loan, you go through his bank account statement and his taxation return, and that is enough to decide on the loaning. So there the technology drive is very high. And in fact, there are fintech companies who have tied up with banks, and it is straight through. Even the applications move through digital and the account is created straight away. Coming to the business loan segment, there the things to be analyzed are a little more. So there again, at the lower end, as it is in PSB loans 59 or in various loan operating systems of banks, for the very small business person, like Mudra loans and all, I think several players are using merely the bank account statements to analyze that they are in business and taking a lending decision. So their mechanization is very easy. A little larger loans, and you use both the bank account statement, and now there has been a change in the taxation system where GST a few years back has revolutionized the way you can get information on somebody's business and transactions. So using the GST inputs and bank account statement, quite a lot of small business lending decisions are happening, not only in banks, but also in NBFCs in a big way. And there, the applicant is also at ease because from his end, he has to only give an authority to bank to analyze these two office statements, and the bank system analyzes it and takes a call on the business loan. So the intervention of technology is very high here. When we go to a little higher end, further on this loaning system, where we call it a larger MSMEs or the smaller mid-corporates, there even more of input is required to be analyzed. So there the technology is already enabling the lenders in analyzing the bank account statements, the GST returns, the income tax returns, and the balance sheets as well, depending on what level of lending is required and what is the size of the borrowing entity. And that also is now stabilizing, and the use, though not very, very extensive, but it is increasing very fast. NBFCs use it in a big way. Private banks have been using it now and improving their loan operating systems to carry this. And public sector banks also are upgrading their systems very fast to incorporate these analysis in their system. So these tools are being incorporated in their loan operating systems for a decision making. And as this happens, I think next 1 year or 1.5 years, there will be a sea change in the way loan operating systems work for assessing loans of MSMEs at a little higher level and the smaller mid-corporates. Going to the larger entities, the technology interventions, though, will be there, but that cannot be the only basis of lending, because there the entire economic scenario of the country and in some of the units, probably global economic scenario, has a big impact. So there, the economic understanding of the economic scene, understanding of the technological inputs, those things also become very important. So the evolution is from the lower end of the lending, and it has reached a level where even mid-level players who are basically either catering to a fixed market, a cluster, or within the country, where the analysis is becoming more technology-driven. This is helping the lenders in not only making the decision faster, but reducing the discretion of the individual who is sanctioning the loans and assisting the decision maker into taking that decision.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for that, insightful introduction on the lending space with respect to the technology. So I'll certainly come back, with further questions on this part to you. Meanwhile, if I can go to Hota sir, can you please switch on the video and unmute yourself? Hota sir, am I audible to you?
Yes, yes.
Can you please switch on the video, please?
Yes. You'll have to start it.
Okay.
I can see that because the host has stopped it.
Just a second. I'm just switching it on. So meanwhile, we are just, addressing this issue, sir. We can have an audio discussion as well.
Sure, sir.
From the payment system, sir, we have seen a lot of advancements from time to time basis, which has, helped in the adoption of digital payments these days. And what we have seen in the recent years is that there has been a huge increase in the usage of debit cards and UPI over the past 2 years. So, on a daily basis, the companies are working on enhancing the customer's experience, and also they are empowering the payment system operators and, the service providers in this industry. So, taking this, as a base root level, so can you please throw some light on the digital intervention which has taken up in the digital payment space, and also that how this industry has grown in the previous years?
Okay. To meet the requirement of the people in various sections, various kinds of payment systems are in place in the country. In fact, almost for every category of payments, there are alternatives. If I really say a very old and traditional method used to be the check, but in today's context, let me not talk about that. So the electronic payments, the first and foremost was the NEFT and NACH, means ACH. In NEFT, it used to be just one-to-one payments. Facility for bulk upload of file was not there, but now that is also available. To make the payment, one means from push type. The person or the institution which is making the payment is pushing money. And also in ACH, there is a pull type. You have already given a mandate and it can be pulled. For in today's context, when you are holding the workshop or webinars for people who are in the lending space, for disbursement of payment and for collection of payments. For disbursement of loans, if it is just one-to-one, you can really NEFT, IMPS, UPI, various methods are there. But if it is a bulk kind of payment, making the payment, NACH is the best. If the number of transactions are very large, possibly you can push a file either through NEFT or you can really do NACH. And now in UPI also, you can do that at the back end if you do, if your aggregator or the payment gateways provides those services. Apart from that, the card payment system is there really to make the payment. That is the best. And either making the payment to the card. But if you are making in the lending area, if you are making the payment in the card, means you can really the prepaid wallet, or there is a prepaid account of the customer, and you can really pay to that prepaid customer. Prepaid customer has got a card, and possibly you can utilize that card if it is bank affiliated on any of the ATMs. And if it is not really, if it is not bank affiliated, now the white level prepaids can also be used on the e-commerce space. UPI is there both pull and push type, and even the mandates have been permitted on the UPI. So that kind of payments. So variety of payment systems are in place for making the payments, and also the collection NACH debit, collection through UPI. These are the two modes particularly, because NEFT does not support pull type. So NACH debit and UPI, these are the two alternatives for collecting money. And also obviously the cards can be done if you are doing on the e-space, e-commerce space, the alternatives you will find: credit card, debit card, and that is the way, and the UPI and the wallets. These are the four broad categories in which the payments can be. So payment systems is quite an evolved one, and all have been functioning extremely. And obviously for a specific category, for bill payment, is there BBPS plus UPI. Bill payment can be done on the UPI as well. And also in the toll gate payment, that toll gate payment is done. Now the tap and go payments and transit payment systems have also come in place with a card being capable of putting the transit payment, enabling transit payments. So the variety, there are varieties of electronic payment transactions in the country now.
Thank you, sir. So I'll certainly come back with your guidance on the further use cases which we will be discussing. But meanwhile, Animesha, coming back to you, sir, where we left the topic, where you have appraised us with the use of technology in the lending space. But sir, still, there's a question in Indian consumers' mindset with respect to, the question is that who all can avail formal credit instead of who all cannot avail, because the percentage gap is has been one of the higher sides globally in India with respect to the access to formal credit for the consumers. So how do you think, sir, that technology can help us to bridge this gap so that we can reach to the last mile of the consumers?
See, as I said, that though for the people who are educated, who use digital platforms, for them, now it has become very easy to get connected to banks and avail loans, even if the income level is lesser. The question is, in our country, there is a vast number, majority of people who were earlier not linked to the banks. With the advent of Jan Dhan accounts in a big way, they have all been onboarded in the bank's platform. And there was a drive to give overdraft in the accounts which were being transacted. So a lot of these people who were earlier in the informal sector and not connected to the banking space have been connected to banks. As far as lending goes, those who have started transacting in their accounts, they are able to avail overdrafts in a very automatic fashion. So not much of the paperwork is required for them to be done. As regards the other requirement, see, recently government went with the public sector banks and maybe some of the private banks, though I'll not have their details, in extending loans to the uncovered agriculturists who were yet to have the KCC accounts. And there, because government has a big database of the agriculturists whom the PM Kisan Yojana gives a credit every quarter, that database was used to make them apply for loans through a very, very simple one-pager format. And the technology that was in place for processing a little larger loans was amended to use to sanction these Kisan credit cards on a very large basis in compressed period of 1 month. I think I don't have the exact figures, but almost 50 lakh loans were sanctioned in a month by banks using that simplified common application form for those who are covered under PM Kisan. So with technology being used by government for its own usage and by banks having their own loan operating systems and sanctioning in place, the two can be combined very well to put those who are not already in the formal sector to be onboarded for taking loans. And with Mudra loans coming out in a big way, lot of these people now have a transaction history with banks. And using that transaction history, their future needs and lending can be done quite easily. So I think that in the last, say, 2 to 3 years, a lot of the informal sector has been brought on board, even with banks, and especially by NBFCs and small finance banks who are adopting to technologies where the customer is not very familiar with the technology, but there are people who reach out to the customer, fill up on behalf of the customer and at the consent of the customer. And then technology is used for onboarding him on the lending platforms. So a lot of work is being done. And going forward, this will enable them to have a history of transactions in banking system, which will enable the lenders to give them credit in a much easier fashion going forward.
Thank you, sir. So I am certainly looking at a way forward in that space. Hota, sir, coming back to the question where you had explained, you know, the different new payment systems which have evolved in the country from that node. So we have, sir, also seen a year-on-year growth of close to 20% with respect to the POS terminal, sir. And, we have also seen a huge amount of growth, close to 28% in terms of the values and the count, in the last year, sir. But looking at these numbers, sir, still the usage of these particular type of technologies in the rural sector is close to 16% in India, sir. So how do you think that we can help, these payment systems to go and benefit the rural segment of the markets?
In fact, these acceptance devices would have to meet the specific needs of that particular community. In the rural areas, if you put a normal type of POS terminals, that means people would have to be quite familiar and they would have to be quite comfortable using the card payment system. So the best thing possibly would be there, it may work very well, is the APS terminal. So APS, they can give the thumb impression and it can work. So I am told by my colleagues in the industry who are in the financial inclusion field that the POS terminals are working extremely, means APS terminal, which is micro ATMs have been working very well. And functionality of the micro ATM is also means quite widened. Means it can also do the function of a normal POS terminal, where the cards can be swiped and cash can be withdrawn and PIN can be given. So the first is the type of, if you are going for a terminal, this is one type. The another type is the, if the customers are comfortable using the QR code, they have really downloaded a package where they can show the QR code and make the payment. Many wallet companies have also really gone for that. So, because after the Bharat QR came, really almost everybody is gradually coming to a common type of QR code. So with that, they can pay by QR code. So if we see this thing, possibly to meet the needs of the people, varieties of terminals are coming up. In the COVID-19, in this coronavirus situation scenario, where when touching itself is seen as a risk, going to keep PIN pads where you really touch frequently for both debit and credit card. Possibly it is a little risky. Not that really it cannot be managed. As it is, 91% of the ATMs are functioning, and so is the number of POS terminals. POS terminals wherever the places are open, like hospitals, they have been working, but. We'll have to see how iris and facial authentication, which UIDAI has already permitted, that can also come up. So anybody who would like to really do, he can stand and iris and face authentication. But it is because the terminals are a little costly, the commercial launch has not taken place. But now I understand the banks are ready to take the bet and support these new technology to come in the cash withdrawal space also. So in the payment, it is an evolutionary process. you will find the people who are very, very educated, and they can handle POS transactions very well or e-commerce transactions very well. They have also been not using digital payment systems. But it is in during this period of lockdown that new customers have come to the digital payments area. And I'm told, I have seen some reports during the last month and a half, close to 5 million new customers have come to the digital payments space. Because the transactions are not happening, because there is not much transactions happening, because most of the shops, restaurants, all closed, the volume is not there. Or else the capability is all there. It is during this period that a great deal of campaign, a lot of campaigns have taken place for digital payments. Governor himself has been asking several times during the day through the various channels that go digital, stay safe. I suppose that is the way to go. This is the opportunity to sensitize people on digital payment space, educate the people about the digital payments. RBI has done significant amount of work to give confidence in digital payment by way of zero liability clause, by building the digital payment ombudsman. That is also a unique step. And now I understand RBI is working and close to launch also a centralized grievance redressal system for entire banking industry. Any bank's customer can lodge the complaint through RBI promoted platform also. So this kind of initiatives are coming, and I suppose signs are very, very few, but last month's lockdown is lifted. So it is moving in the right speed. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for updating on these numbers and, you know, the new initiatives which the RBI is coming up with. So we'll, in the further questions, we'll have discussions on these, sir. Animesh, sir, coming back to the lending space. Yes. You know, we all as a consumer, we agree that different organizations are at different levels of adaptability of technology. I mean, we have fintech firms who are using the technology to the core, and they have, made their systems to an extent of 90-95% towards an automation layer, followed by NBFCs where the technology percentage is even higher. But when we look at the public sector banking space, sir, how do you think that they are coming up with respect to the use of technology in lending, and what are the advancements which the banks, post this COVID-19 scenario also should look at?
See, public sector banks also, because they have large operating volumes, the change adaptation is a bit slower. And public sector bank space for the last 2-3 years have been going through the NPA issue in a big way. But even during that period, look at, they have all adopted and improved their loan operating systems at the back end. That means within the bank, the sanctioning of loans has been done through loan operating systems, especially the retail loans and the MSME loan segment. They are also in a big way planning for mid-corporates to be assessed through various inputs in the loan operating system. So on the retail front, because there are less number of things, analysis to be done, the adoption has been faster in public sector banks also. All of them are using some of the other systems on which they are sanctioning. In MSME space, some have also provided the loan tracking system to the customers, and customers are able to track their loans. Not all, but some have already started that. And with almost every public sector banks, at least the larger ones are working on it in a big way. Next 6 months to 1 year, as with the mergers happening, the sizes go up. and their capability of investing in the IT systems also goes up, they will be ramping up these operating systems with various APIs, like, as we said, incorporating the various analysis of balance sheet, the legal system, legal analysis of the company, the GST returns, the bank statements, the stock statements. And with all that analysis done in their loan operating systems, the quantum of loans that can be assessed through that system can go up and can cover the mid-corporate space as well. Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Yeah. So it is possible then to increase the size of lending through these operating systems. And now the core banking system has been upgraded in most of the banks to a level where that these loan operating systems can be plugged in and plugged out.
Correct.
So all the advancements that are happening, they can be tacked on to their loan operating systems. And that also gives space to various fintech companies to keep on developing newer systems of analysis, which can be added on to these loan, which can ride on these loan operating systems for decision making. Yes, in larger advances, there still be requirement of a individual's view on the company going forward, because though the historic analysis will all be available, but the future changes in economy have to still be understood from the economic context, and the changes of the government's laws and regulations for globally and within the country have also to be understood for taking a credit decision. So that much part will still remain out of the domain of the technology for the near future. Maybe going forward, all that also can be incorporated. And so I think PSBs also have been moving in a big way. The impact is likely to be seen very soon in the at least MSME and mid-corporate space. On the retail front, it is already there. Yes, still there is in the personal loan segment where fintech tie-ups are in place, even the applications are on digital that are lending on the public sector banks platforms. But apart from that, the applications and disbursals are not digitized to that extent, but the analysis and the requirement of submission to banks is shrinking very fast. And that will help ease the customer's interaction with the banks. Number of visits will be less, the number of papers required is going down, and the decision making has become faster. And in the coming days, it will be even faster. Yes, COVID is a very specific situation. And I don't think that any technological analysis so far has covered, because I don't think anybody in the world knows how it is going to end up and what will be the total impact on the various economies, especially those industries. The impact is different in different countries. And so the entire payment cycle or the working capital cycle of the industry, whether it is manufacturing or it is a service sector, may undergo a change, at least in a shorter run. And when I say shorter run, maybe for a year or two. And it will take time to re-establish the old order in the system. As is being projected, India is expected to come back on track very fast, because the numbers are restricted in our place. We have a lot of green areas where there is no impact. And from 20th onward, a lot of the activity will restart. So I think the lending process also will restart faster in India. And Indian companies will have a great avenue opening up globally to push their products and manufacturing. But that is yet to be seen and established and analyzed. And going forward, it will have to be watched on a very regular basis. How it is adopted to it faster will be benefiting a lot. And I'm sure banks will be very eager to lend, because that is how their lendings will take off in the near
future. Thank you, sir. Thank you for this update from that note. And sir, just in continuation to this, Anime sir, that you know, there are a lot of new age lending models which have come up in the market with respect to NBFCs and fintech firms. Now we can talk about a salary advance loans or you know, POS based transaction loans. So how do you think that the banks are, the public sector banks are coming into this space, number one? And number two, that most of these loans, you know, are evaluated where the customers are a part of the digital journey of a loan, sir. Still, we see that in majority of the banks, it is the bank's officials who are using the technology as a tool with them, but the customer is not a part of the, you know, the digital loan journey. So how do you think banks coming up in this space, you know, on the innovative lending models and also involving customers in the digital journey so as to reduce the turnaround time of a loan?
See, in a lot of personal loan space, the banks have also tied up with various fintechs. And a lot of banks are now very aggressively tying up with fintechs where the entire application and documentation is digitalized. So that is happening in personal loan space the fastest. Going into MSMEs, yes, it is slow, especially in public sector banks, because the size is very huge and the adoption of technology has to happen with the entire size, and it requires training and understanding by the personnel. But a lot of work is happening behind the scene where in near future, you'll see the applications from the customer end moving in on a digital platform, and banks also taking a decision without a face-to-face interaction by studying the formats. It will certainly start in some segments faster. As we know, in the LC discounting space or in the bills discounting for international trade, it has public sector banks have already started giving customers the direct access to their platforms for sending the bills and loading it on the system where they need not visit the branches. Similarly, personal loans, as I said, tie up through fintechs has happened. MSME is the next segment where it will be working around. But see, even today, the filling up of various requirements, we have seen people have been, wherever the loan is a bit complicated and requires to be explained, the formats that are loaded in banks may not be the only space where it can be explained to the banks. So their little interaction is required. The thing is that now, instead of the customer reaching out to bank, the tide is changing for the bank's staff reaching out to customer to fill up these formats. Even in NBFC space, when we say the small and MSMEs, it is the keying in on the system is being done by the representative of the NBFCs. The customer may not, but yes, the customer is not required to fill up the entire format space. The same thing is getting developed in public sector banks also, where the loan operating system, based on the inputs given, generates an application which needs to be then authenticated either through digital or through physical signatures. But yes, the impact in public sector, because various banks are at different levels of digitization in this space, will be felt probably in different banks at different levels. But next 1 year is going to be critical. You will see a lot of expansion of this space in the in very soon, maybe next 1 year. Probably COVID has taken it back a bit, but then post that, it is expected to come even faster.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I think that you know, this is certainly which has been enabled. Ota sir, you know, coming back to you, sir. With respect to credit cards, you know, there's a understanding that you know, what is the way forward? That are credit card systems and digital lending products competing with each other, sir? Sir, can you unmute yourself, please?
Yes. I could not hear. Can you, the last part?
Are the credit card systems competing with the digital lending products, sir? What's your take on that?
Obviously, you know, credit card as a, it is an asset class for the bank. It is a non-collateralized asset class. You just see the creditworthiness of the customer and give a loan. And you really, the in fact, it is also a form of loan. And that is repaid either 100% at the end of the billing cycle or in the installment. And if you pay in installment, obviously you really pay the interest as well. And that interest is the really the revenue income for the credit card company. So it is a form of credit, but it is relevant where the amount is also significantly less. 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 5 lakh. I am aware of the 10 lakh. But obviously, if someone is asking for 10 lakh or more, credit card really cannot really solve this problem. And credit card is only for short-term loan, means it is less than a year. But if you would like to really take the credit for over a period of really 3 years to 5 years or something, credit card cannot help. So for a very short-term personal consumption loan, credit card is the best, and it is also a very good means to pay. It is a payment means as well. It is a credit facility plus a payment method. So it combines both. And it is for less than 1 year if you would like to really pay. So it is from that angle that the competition scenario can be compared. The people who would require for just 6 months or 10 months like this. But I see a great potential for mass credit card also. I suppose the system has not evolved that much, but days are not far up. After all, any NBFC can also think of launching a credit card. The only qualification is it has to be an NBFC and it has got to be a special license. So this is what I see in the country missing. Either credit card means either Visa, MasterCard, RuPay card, the card issued by the banks, or like a non-bank, like really you can say SBI card, and a special NBFC really giving a credit card. And that credit card being sold out by various banks, 15, 16 or some number, good deal of banks. So there also there is a room for competition for mass market credit card, where credit worthiness as per the evaluation may not be for high end, maybe just 1 lakh, 2 lakh amount is quite a good. So that way, for a very low value credit amount, credit card can be a good competitor.
Thank you, sir. So definitely, I think that's a good takeaway from the session to take up. Sir, coming up to, you discussed about credit worthiness, sir. So do you think that the payment system data can help in deriving the credit scoring of any individual or an entity?
Yes, it can. Maybe it can be one of the components of credit scoring. But the challenge over here is how do you get the credit card in a score? Even if the customer gives the consent by way of a particular structure, that the payment data would come through NPCI, through credit card companies, and gets over there. How to make use of that? The companies themselves will not be able to, the processing company like NPCI and others, they cannot share the data because payment system data is very confidential data. In fact, NPCI, it's within NPCI setup itself, even people will not have the access to it because it is kept in masked condition. It is only for processing requirement and only for resolution of disputes that it can be tracked, or else it cannot be seen. So a consent regime has to factor this, and the credit bureaus may possibly do it. Possibly credit bureau can expand the scope of their activities with the consent of the regulator by creating a consent regime. That customer will give a consent that my data in the processing companies may be procured. Or now the account aggregator rules have come. And once the account aggregator start operating in a big way, maybe this is also another area through that the data can be shared. The data can be not shared, the data can be transmitted from the storage box, black box of payment system black box to the respective agencies. So it is possible to do that. And what can be the weightage may differ from the segment of people to one segment to another segment. In some segment, maybe at a lower economic segment or lower middle class, maybe the bill payment and different kind of grocery payments. After all, from the IDs, merchant code, they can easily find out what is the kind of consumption that the concerned person has done it. This is the payment and this is the purpose of the payment. Data is there in the system. So now the question is, how do you really build the consent regime on the top of that? I suppose, as I understand, some work is on to get the consent of the regulator, and thereafter it can happen.
Yes, certainly, sir. I think a new partnership space will certainly put this industry also, and if it is allowed to use that data, it can be a huge enabler for any decision maker on that part, sir.
Yes. Anyway, sir, but as it is only one thing, if anybody gives the data, it is not for commercial exploitation, or else it will go against the spirit of the payment system regulator. So if any data has to be given, it has to be given on as per the transparent rules and regulations.
Correct, sir. Absolutely. So, Anime sir, coming back, with respect to the credit worthiness and the use of availability of data in the lending space, sir, how do you think, sir, that fundamental guidelines which are being coming up on the account aggregation now can help, lending space? And also, if you can just throw some light on the usage of integrated credit appraisal reports these days by, all the banks and NBFCs from that point.
See, account aggregator system is yet to commence properly in India. There are very few companies who are in the incubation part, and its wider commercial use is yet to be started. But yes, it's a very good concept where giving consent for usage of data is very regulated. Means the customer gives the consent to use what data points can be, he can decide the data points which is authorizing to be conveyed to the concerned agency and for the purpose for which that agency can use it. See, because today, if a customer has to give consent, he has to give a separate consent for GST, a separate consent for using his bank account statement, maybe a separate consent for, as we were, Hotaji was talking, for his credit card usage and payment, and all those separate consents are required to be given. And so it becomes that much more cumbersome for him to give the consent and for the agency to use those consents and generate the data. For the account aggregator, they have access to entire data system, ecosystem, but they can use it only when the customer consent is there, either based on through his OTPs or consents through mail or whatever format they take a call on. Once the account aggregator system is established properly, the consent can be given very fast and can be given through one authority and for whatever number of data that you want to be conveyed to the agencies. And that agency can get all that data in one go and can use it for taking a studied decision on the, if we are talking of lending, on the lending to that particular customer. That should help in a big way. And this will also help in automating various application formats from the customer, because now those details, if you are getting it directly from account aggregator, may not be asked from the customer. Already a lot of things are not being asked because those which you can download from authority may not be asked from the customer. That is already in the offing. That is already being built in the system. But with the account aggregator coming in, the loan application can be much simpler. And with the authorities, which can get the lender the entire data, and a decision can be taken very fast. Yes, what was the second question?
So second question was basically on the usage of integrated credit appraisal reports these days, sir.
See, integrated credit appraisal reports will be designed by different banks on their own requirement and at the level at which they want to use it. So, see, if NBFCs are using it, probably it is because they cater to one strata in a big numbers. The strata is common, the number is big. So the integrated reports can be used. Public sector banks, because they cater to the entire strata, the entire vertical, and the numbers may not be that big in each strata, they will have to devise a method for a larger use. But yes, the usage going forward has to go up in this direction, even in the banking space.
Absolutely agree, sir. Thank you for this, sir. So, Hota, sir, coming back to you, you know, with the last question on this particular part, sir, that, you know, how do you think, number one, can new technology means like artificial intelligence or DTLs be used in the, the payment systems gateway? And also, how do you think that the payment systems can support the monitoring in the utilization of the disbursed amounts, sir? So can you please unmute yourself?
The banks who are maintaining the account of the customer from which credit card or debit card has been issued, whenever payment happens, the details of the payment, particularly if it is paid in card, it comes to the bank. So bank has the information as to how it is utilized. That is why you would find a good number of now lending companies, NBFCs and MFIs, they are going for prepaid cards. Because if they disburse the loans to the card account, prepaid account, and thereafter really they start spending it on online space, they would be in a position, after all, the data comes to that particular institution for approval. Along with the data, really the purpose, where which merchant the data comes. So they would be able to monitor the utilization or the spending pattern of the customer. So that is the way really they know. Or else, obviously, how the spend certificate in the age-old traditional method that you can take the purpose for which the consumption has been spent has been done. So this, you will find these days in the internet banking, also most of the banks are giving the spend analysis, money manager utility, as an add-on service to the customer. It, in fact, it is partly out of the need for the customer and partly the bank's own needs to see how the, if the customer has taken the loan, how it is being spent. So that it serves both the purpose. So not very accurately, but to some extent it is possible to do if the payment is made digital. But if the loan is credited into the account and thereafter the borrower, if it is a small amount, just pays by, by cash, or by check, because for the check also the purpose is not mentioned. Of course, the beneficiary would have been written, but it would require a little bit of effort to analyze how it is spent. But if it is digitally done, it is pretty easy for the lender or the banker.
Correct, sir. Got it, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And in fact, you know, it's the limitation of the time that we will now have to move on to the Q&A section, although the topic is such that you can have multiple hours of discussion here, sir. And, you know, it's been such a great honor for us to have both of you in this webinar today. You know, the insights that you have given, I think will certainly help the attendees in a big way. So we, during the entire session, so we have more than 200 attendees in the case. So we have time for a quick question, sir. Although I would request all the attendees to please over an email after this webinar. But sir, just a quick question, Animesh sir, which one of the questions were addressed to you is that how will the banks solve the problem of signing the legal documents, while they are going towards the digitization of the lending space, sir?
See, in personal loans, already the documents are sent to the customer and he digitally signs and returns. That is available because digital signature is a legal way of signing documents already. So signing of documents is on the digital space can happen. It is happening only on the personal loan fronts in a big way at present. When through fintech companies, when we are disbursing loans, it is happening. But that part can be taken care in future in the larger accounts also, because legally speaking, a digital signature appended to a document is as good as a signature appended. Yes, on companies, then the digital signature of the company has to evolve for that. So it will have to be taken through that only.
Yeah, sir.
From the chat, I can see one question relating to stamp duty payment, or because currently, even after the e-stamping, a great deal of dependency is there on franking, as well as placing the document on the bond paper, particularly for loan agreement. Yes. So the only way out is really how the whole process can be done digital.
Yes.
And I know the Indian Banks Association is working towards that, for integrating e-stamping. Stamp duty payment
yes.
to the state government, and taking that receipt, if it can come in a very secured manner, that can be integrated with the loan document.
Even
now the beginning has been made with the loan document. Possibly something will be way out, but as I understand, sir, really the government, Delhi government, where it has started, they have permitted only for bank guarantee.
Yes. Now, what is happening, sir, is that e-stamping, if it can be used on digital documents,
yes.
then it can be very smooth. But
yes.
there, it is a combination of banks agreeing to it, and banks will agree as soon as it gets a legal sanctity. And that is already in process of discussion. I hope in with this present government's push towards digital, very soon
yes.
this regulatory clearance will also come.
Yes. And now also the ICC, International Chamber of Commerce, for the COVID directives, advisory to all the governments and the central banks, they have also advised to go for a digital integration of stamp duty payment
yes.
of the various other measures. This is also one, how it
yes.
can be integrated with the smart contracts and stamping. So both should be fused as a single process. So automated process should be there.
Yes, one is the process and one is the legal sanctity to those documents. So I hope those will come in the next 1 year, certainly.
Yes, yes. Yes. It's been cleared because I'm aware that IBA and the Swift India, they are doing this thing and it is already operational in Delhi, but not for the bank agreement. And banks
yes.
are eagerly waiting for these clearances.
Yes, yes, because this reduces, see, it not only eases for the customer, it also eases for the bank.
Thanks, yes.
The transaction.
Yes.
Yes, Shashank, over to you.
So, sir, further going forward, we can take one last question on this part, is that, with respect to this digital signing and also on the e-stamping part. So, the attendees are asking that, this is a still very untapped market in the country and the cost component is very high. So, how does this become affordable for the customer to use this?
See, the stamping cost is not something that is in the hands of the bank. Stamping cost is regulated by the state government and the central government's Stamps Act. So banks cannot control this. For this, the decision has to come from government, because even equitable mortgages are to be registered, then a stamp duty has to be paid, varying from government to government. And therefore, I know that people are apprehensive, because some of the customers, when COVID loans are being sanctioned by banks, there is an issue of stamp duty being paid. And for that, we have to go for a physical stamp, a physical signing of the documents. Once this, that is why this has come in a big way in discussions, that even if COVID, when I am going to disburse a specific COVID loan, I have to do the documentation in physical form. So this has triggered this discussion in a faster, has speeded up the discussion. But still, it is a discussion on how it is to be digitalized. And as to the stamp value, it is certainly between the government and the public, and not for the bank to take a call on that.
Correct. Absolutely. Hota, sir, another question, probably which we can take is with respect to, the e-way bills and the FASTag data, which is today available. So one of the attendees is asking that, can we harness this data with respect to, credit worthiness or towards the lending of the individual?
Oh, yes, it is possible, because one thing that Indian Banks Association has already done, they have already advised, and it has been to a large extent already implemented, that any customer taking trade finance, whenever they submit any trade document, they must also submit the e-way bill. Previously, that requirement was not there, and now they have made it more or less a mandatory. In certain banks, they have almost a mandate, and for certain other banks, it is still in the process, because this is not a regulatory guideline. This is a IBI advisory. So some banks are in the process of implementing. Once that happens, the banks can really, with the consent of the customer, after all, bank customer is taking loans, facilities, they must give the consent. So if the consent is already there for a particular period, during that particular period, all the e-way bills they can really collect. What is the data pertaining to that e-way bill? After all, linked invoices, linked deals, all can be seen by the bank. And from a means data which is in the repository of the government, a sovereign, from the sovereign repository, a verification is done. So banks have started doing it as a risk management process. And in fact, there were initially a few fear that it may lead to a fraudulent way of doing it, create a e-way bill, and thereafter you don't really send the goods. It may happen like that. So it is now double verification through the GST payment also. So when the invoice is being paid, that time GST would be there. So an integrated linkage platform is being developed, whereby verification on the part of the bank is also easy for the customers. Everything, the bank does not have to repeatedly ask the customer for different kind of proofs. Everything is already there. And I gather that even the government is thinking the way e-way bill can be generated from a single source, the same way the invoice should also be generated from a single source. And it is under experimentation, but it has not started. And there are a few countries like Brazil, all invoices can be really generated only from the sovereign system, so that there is no leakage of GST and other things also. So such innovations are also, digitization is going to take place in the years to come in a very big way. And groundwork has already been done by the government of India. Banks should also be a part of this whole system. So digitization of trade and digitization of payments all would get integrated.
Yes.
Very good systems are in the pipeline in the days ahead. So those who are in the field of providing solutions for the companies and the fintech firms, they have a very, very good way of really being providing a lot of value addition to the to this entire system. Thank you. Back to you, Sasank.
So thank you, sir. I think thank you so much for this insightful discussion which we had today. I think the deliberations was very deep down, and we have addressed a lot of issues with respect to lending as well as on the payment side. it's a limitation of time that we have to end here. Otherwise, I would have, you know, preferred to take this session even forward and, you know, discuss some other issues as well as possible. In fact, there are, you know, more than 25 questions which are still unaddressed. But yes, I would request if we can mail across the copies of these questions to you, and if you can give your feedback on them so that we can share it with the attendees.
You are always welcome to do that.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank you again. It was an honor having both of you here, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Shashank. Thank you, Otaji, and thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Signing off.